Well, this is it. Monday is the anniversary of Hurricane Ida, something that none of us will ever forget, least of all Parish President Robby Miller. And as we approach this anniversary, you've compiled some statistics on Ida, some of which are really astronomical, like the amount of debris that was collected just here in Tangipahoa.
That's true, Ken. Like you said, Ida's basically a year away. You know, our citizens really worked hard to get us out of that terrible situation we woke up to that morning. Worked very hard to move the debris out of the way. Then over the last year, we've been picking it up and moving it. And everybody knows those big trucks with the two trailers on them. And we figured out that if you line those trucks up bumper to bumper from Man Shack, with the amount of debris we hauled from Man Shack to 120 miles north of Memphis, Tennessee, Sikeston, Missouri is where it would go to. 120 miles north of Memphis is how long those trucks would be. A little over 3 million cubic yards. And whenever I talk about it, it's like 3 million cubic yards doesn't mean anything to me. But those trucks lined up from here to 120 miles past Memphis does mean something to me. I get that, and I think all of our citizens would too. So, but if you drove through our parish right after the storm, and even weeks after the storm while that debris was still on the ground, and everywhere you went, every road you went on, every neighborhood you went into, state highway, local highway, it didn't matter what it was, the debris was stacked up everywhere. So we know that we got hit very hard from Ida, and I think we're in pretty good shape today.
Matter of fact, you couldn't have imagined a worse track for the storm relative to us, and yet it even stalled over Hammond and Ponchatoula. So this was literally a worst-case scenario for a Cat 5 hurricane.
Well, I sure hope it's the worst-case scenario. It shifted and drove straight up I-55. I think it literally drove up I-55 and just did its damage everywhere. Thankfully, we didn't have... we had some spot flooding, flash flooding because of the amount of rain, but we didn't have the coastal push. We didn't have a lot of water, river flooding like we'd had in the past. So thankfully the rain was short-lived, very hard at one time, moved on, and as it moved away, we were able to handle it. So, we basically had wind damage, which was significant from a lot of people. It was very, very significant. So as a whole, though, our parish is in really good shape today. And we're doing much better than anybody probably would have thought we'd have made it at this point.
Look, I know energy is a convenient whipping boy, maybe deserves some of it, but one thing, doesn't it appear that our electrical grid is more secure today than it was before? Many of the poles, true, they were knocked down, but they've been replaced with better poles than we had before, and some of the wiring is more robust than it was before.
Well, that's what energy tells us that they were doing is as they rebuilt with bigger, better. The poles are supposedly can handle 150 mile an hour winds. The wiring, they went back where it was band-aided to get it power back on. They came back through after that and did some more work. They're working on a big push to improve even more of the system that wasn't damaged, but that's old. So we'll see that coming down the road. Hopefully that'll work out. But, we know that electrical service was bad. I want to commend, and I've said this several times, we'll make sure we catch it again, that our sewer district and our water district did a phenomenal job. Their systems, their system stayed up the whole time. I don't think they were down at all. Now, there might have been patches throughout the parish where sewer water lines were pulled out of the ground by trees, and that's because their system was maintained, because they were prepared. They worked with our emergency management team, Dawson Primes and Vicky, to make sure they had everything they needed to be ready. So their system, they didn't have to focus on getting their system up and running. They only had to focus on going out into the field and getting those areas taken care of. So got to pat them on the back, because without electricity, things are bad. Without sewer and water and electricity, they're purely miserable within about 24 to 48 hours. So those guys did a really good job.
Everything's a learning experience. What did we learn from Ida that'll make us better prepared next time?
I think that maybe one of the things we learned is that the conventional wisdom was to house workers like in safety in one place in our hardened buildings, which we did, and then they go and get their equipment and go out. Well, but the way this storm happened, we couldn't get out to go get to our equipment, or our guys couldn't, our equipment was trapped. So I think we've got a little different plan where we're gonna have some folks there, and we're gonna stage some equipment and people out in the parish to work back into us or out to other areas so that we don't have to work so hard without equipment getting to do our job. And look, citizens came through on that. I talked about this multiple times. That's another big group to pat on the back. Our first responders, police, fire, and then citizens who had equipment, who had chainsaws, who had tractors, all the various farm equipment that they used to clear the roads to get us moving. And really, at about 48 hours after the storm, you could go down any road. Might not have been safe, very, very safe, you know, one lane maybe, slow moving, but you could get throughout the parish in about 48 hours because of the big effort on all of the municipalities and our folks in the public works, all the first responders, fire and police, and then throw in the citizens, and we did a bang-up job to get us moving around. Then the contractors came in and started clearing the roads completely.
Most of the debris you're talking about was trees.
Correct.
We've lost a lot of trees. We're down a lot of trees. Have we replanted smarter, or have we lost some trees that we're not going to replant because, frankly, they take down electric service?
Well, I would venture to say that where their trees can be replanted in the you know, the forestry industry is going to make sure they get their business back going. There's some trees we're never going to, some of the live oaks that went down, some of the big pines that went down. And I can tell you that a lot of folks decided that they didn't want those trees close to their home, so they helped get them out of there too. But I think, you know, even when you look at the number of trees we hauled out and then you look at the number of trees we still have, we must have millions of trees.
Well, you know, thinking about it over my lifetime, Smart Alec, I think every storm we've had that I've ever seen, afterwards, we have emerged a little better off for next time, because frankly, you learn some things. And as you mentioned, maybe a lot of these trees should have never been planted there in the first place, or not the ones, the big, tall ponderosa pines that we like so much.
Well, we always learn a lot. The big thing I think we learned is how well we work together, the idea that we move whenever things need to happen. Our citizens really do that. And then some things that we need to make sure we take care of. There's some citizens who don't realize that the resources are available. We've got to work a little harder, and we're working on a plan to find those people sooner to make sure that they're not kind of on an island because they don't know which way to turn. So we're working to find them still today, those folks, and we're working on a system to make sure we find them much sooner after the storm.
Well, the Emergency Operations Center that you have in Ameet, I mean, it really was the envy of the whole region, and that enabled us to just move so much faster than a lot of parishes that were hit.
Well, I would like to think that. I mean, I quite frankly, I know what we do, and I think the rest of the guys around our areas work as hard as we do. I would like to think that our team works is better, is the best. I say it all the time, we're the best parish in the state. It's not necessarily to brag so much as to say that our folks just are dedicated that hard to make sure that they're not going to fail. They're going to do everything possible to not fail and to make sure we service and take care of the citizens of our parish. This region of our state is incredible. The North Shore really is a gem for almost anywhere in the country. Whenever people come to visit and come to Tangipahoa and they go to our neighboring parishes, they can't get over the friendliness and what's available to us and how beautiful it is. And so it's just really nice to be in the center of that and to sometimes be the focus that we've done it well.
Well, now that we're really moving into the hardcore of hurricane season, what else do you want to share with us?
Well, we need to always be ready. You know, so far there hadn't been a hurricane announced, any watches or anything, but we always need to be ready. It doesn't take long for a hurricane to spin up, for things to change. So make sure you have your plan, you know what you're going to do, pay attention to the weather reports, and be ready to listen to what we say and take action. You know, right now we're just dealing with all this rain every day. I mean, there's just so much rain every day. Our yards are all soaked. The canals and all are pretty much full, but the water is moving. It's draining. So I think overall we're handling it all pretty well.
Which reminds me, how much debris is left to be removed from our big drainage laterals and, for that matter, the rivers?
Well, through some grant opportunities with the drainage district and the parish went for undistricted areas in drainage. I think we're spending right now, we have grant money and our money, the drainage district and ours and everybody, roughly $60 million being spent to clear they were identified through engineering experts on which ones to go to first, the most, what's the right word, the ones that move the most water, the biggest ones, and the ones that are most critical coming off the river or to the river. To make sure that they're getting the most water out of here, and then move backwards from there. There's another round of grant opportunity that we've push for to get another chunk of money, hopefully in the 10, 15, 20 million more dollars to do it. It's just it was a lot of trees. There were average of roughly 40 plus trees per mile per drainage lateral.
So here's my last question. Every place has weather that they don't like. There's wildfires, earthquakes, the epic thunderstorms you get every year in Oklahoma. So look, we're stuck with hurricanes. Mother Nature gives us that. But would you trade that for anything? Like, what if we got earthquakes?
I don't think so. As much as hurricanes, because we know they're coming. You know, we get a notice, even if it's short notice, we know they're coming. We know what to do with them. Tornadoes just show up. Earthquakes just show up. Wildfires, for the most part, when they initially start, you don't know what they're going to turn into. So, I, as much as hurricanes are damaging, as much as they affect us, we know how to deal with them. And I guess that's because we grew up dealing with them. And I would venture to say the folks out there don't want to deal with hurricanes, but we'll stay here in Louisiana. I love Louisiana. I think we'll just stay here and deal with our hurricanes.
Plus very little, if any, snow.
Exactly. Although we've had our share much more snow than we need to have, for sure. We don't know how to handle snow.